our hearts have felt. And our minds have sensed and thought. For all the subtleties by which thy spirit is overcome in us, the things that resist and divide. For all that has blessed us with the sense of the presence of the Master, we don't know how to thank thee, our Father. We can only say how glad we are that we have been thus privileged. Walk beside us in the way that we take. Give unto our feeble steps thy strength, that we may do and be in accordance with thy will and thy dream, so that in us thou wilt not be ashamed or embarrassed or humiliated. O God, our Father, our Father.
And the tempter came and said to him, "If you are the Son of God, command these stones to become loaves of bread." But he answered, "It is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God." Then the devil took him to the holy city and set him on the pinnacle of the temple and said to him, if you are the Son of God, throw yourself down, for it is written, he will give his angels charge of you, and on their hands they will bear you up, lest you strike your foot against a stone. Jesus said to him, again it is written, you shall not tempt the Lord your God. Again the devil took him to a very high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world and the glory of them. And he said to him, all these I will give you if you will fall down and worship me. Then Jesus said to him, be gone, Satan, for it is written, you shall worship the Lord your God, and him only shall you serve. Then the devil left him, and behold, angels came and ministered to him. Seeing the crowds, Jesus went up on the mountain. And when he sat down, his disciples came to him. And he opened his mouth and taught them, saying, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be satisfied. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when men revile you and persecute you and utter all kinds of evil against you falsely on my account. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward is great in heaven. For so men persecuted the prophets who were before you. No one can serve two masters, for either he will hate the one and love the other, or he will be devoted to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and mammon. Therefore, I tell you, do not be anxious about your life, what you shall eat, or what you shall drink, nor about your body, what you shall put on. Is not life more than food, and the body more than clothing? Look at the birds of the air. They neither sow nor reap nor gather into barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not of more value than they? And which of you, by being anxious, can add one cubit to his span of life? And why are you anxious about clothing? Consider the lilies of the field, how they grow. They neither toil nor spin. Yet I tell you, even Solomon in all his glory was not arrayed like one of these. But if God so clothes the grass of the field, which today is alive and tomorrow is thrown into the oven, will he not much more clothe you, O man of little faith? Therefore, do not be anxious, saying, what shall we eat? Or what shall we drink? Or what shall we wear? For the Gentiles seek all these things, and your heavenly Father knows that you need them all. But seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things shall be yours as well. The woman of Samaria, I shall read first, and then Nicodemus. He came to me with his eyes and asked for water, stretched out his hand and spoke. His mind burned into mine like the noon sun. My pitcher of thoughts broke. I had not noticed him at rest by the wellhead shadowed by the rare tree. But as I carried my shame into its coolness, his eyes awaited me. I tried to avoid them as I drew the well rope taut through a mindless hand. I saw his robe cross the speckled sunlight, his feet stir the white sand. I saw his face. It was white with road dust, whiter than any stone. But his eyes were ageless and deep as well shafts as they met my own. They unroofed my brain with their profound gazing, made the heart a molten thing. Every perverted thought unveiled itself under their questioning. He spoke of water to cleanse the spirit. I tried not to understand. He followed me along the road of my evasions. And when it ceased in sand, he brought me home from my self-forced journey. He showed me my own soul, cracked and dry as a discarded wineskin, and made it whole. He came to me with his eyes and asked for water, stretched out his hands and spoke. As I carried my peace back to the streets of Sica, a new world woke. It is so very good, our Father, to have the long respite from the things that involve us so deeply as we pursue our private enterprises, to have a long interval in which to contemplate the meaning of our own lives in the presence of the life of Him who speaks so directly to us when we are most ourselves. We do not burden our minds, our Father, with all of the notions that have been a part of our upbringing and our thinking. But here in the quietness, we seek the original sense, the first moving impact of His life upon those who had with Him at that far off time the first great moment of personal revelation. We lay bare ourselves to as much of His Spirit as we can sense and feel and grasp, placing upon that exposure no great demand. O Sabbath rest by Galilee, O calm of hills above, where Jesus knelt to share with thee the silence of eternity, interpreted by love. Drop thy still dews of quietness till all our striving cease. Take from our souls the strain and stress, and let our ordered lives confess the beauty of thy peace.
And for us in this waiting moment, our Father, this is enough. wonder whether he was a man of flesh and blood like ourselves, says this woman disciple, or a thought without a body in the mind, or an idea that visits the vision of man. Often it seems to me that he was but a dream, dreamed by countless men and women at the same time in a sleep deeper than sleep and a dawn more serene than all dawns. And it seems that in relating the dream, the one to the other, we began to deem it a reality that had indeed come to pass. And in giving it body of our fancy and a voice of our longing, we made it a substance of our own substance. But in truth, he was not a dream. We knew him for 3 years and beheld him with our open eyes in the high tide of noon. We touched his hands and we followed him from one place to another. We heard his discourses and witnessed his deeds. Think you that we were a thought seeking after more thought, or a dream in the region of dreams? Great events always seem alien to our daily lives, though their nature may be rooted in our nature. But though they appear sudden in their coming and sudden in their passing, their true span is for years and for generations. Jesus of Nazareth was himself the great event. That man whose father and mother and brothers we know was himself a miracle wrought in Judea. Yea, all his own miracles, if placed at his feet, would not rise to the height of his ankles. And you and I, though born again and again, shall keep them. And now I would go into my house and stand an exalted beggar at his feet. He was the first to conceive the divided races as a unity. Before his time, there had been gods and men, and feeling through the mysticism of sympathy that in himself each had been made incarnate, he calls himself the son of the one or the son of the other according to his mood. More than anyone else in history, he wakes in us that temper of wonder. There is still something to me almost incredible in the idea of a young Galilean peasant imagining that he could bear on his own shoulders the burden of the entire world. All that had already been done and suffered, and all that was yet to be done and suffered, the sins of Nero, of the Caesars, of Alexander the Sixth, and of him who was emperor of Rome and priest of the sun, the suffering of those whose names are legion and whose dwelling is among the tombs, oppressed nationalities, factory children, thieves, people in prison,
outcasts, those who are dumb under oppression and whose silence is heard only of God, and not merely imagining this, but actually achieving it so that at the present moment, all who come in contact with his personality, even though they may neither bow to his altar nor kneel before his priest, in some way find that the ugliness of their sin is taken away and the beauty of their sorrow is revealed to them. My father prayed as he drew a bead on the gray coat back in those blazing years when the house was divided. Bless his old heart. There never was truer or kinder, yet he prayed while hoping the ball from the clumsy old musket might thud to the body of some hot-eyed young southerner and tumble him limp in the mud of the Vicksburg trenches. That was my father, serving the Lord and his country, praying and shooting wholeheartedly, never a doubt. And now, what about me in my own day of battle? Could I put my prayers behind a slim Springfield bullet? Hardly, except to mutter, Jesus, Jesus. We part here. My country calls for my body and takes my soul also. Do you see those humans herded and driven against me? Turn away, Jesus, for I've got to kill them. Why? Oh, well, it's the way of my fathers, and such evils bring some vast, vague good to my country. I do not know why, but today my business is killing, and my gods must be luck and the devil till this thing is over. Leave me now, Lord. Your eyes make me slack in my duty. My father could mix his prayers with his shooting, and he was a rare true man in his generation. Now I'm fairly decent in mine, I guess. Yet, if I should pray like him, I'd spoil it by laughing.
what is the matter? Jesus, we part here. The struggle of one man who came under the tremendous impact of the life of the Master has come down to us in the record, in the story of Nicodemus, a very gifted English poet has taken the essence of that story and given wings to it in these rather extensive words. You will say, I am ancient and cautious as a tortoise. Yes, and you will be right. But can he help being a tortoise? And can I help being I? Is it possible to cast one's nature like a snake's skin by desire and will, by an act of the imagination? He said men could, and I once believed him, though in my character only cautiously believed. Custom, I suppose, dictates a sheltered childhood, comfort and servants, every move prescribed, every request forestalled, and later in scholarship, walking along the carefully trodden paths, fitting my sandals in the approved footprints. To others, no doubt, an object of admiration. But to me, who lived closer to myself than they did, lacking one last possession, I lacked all. For you see, though I could quote the scriptures, arguing for hours on the minutest quibble, my philosophy was valueless. I could discuss life, but life itself, the final mystery, always eluded me. What was life's purpose? Could man incomplete complete himself, unsatisfied find satisfaction? And then one day, it was Passover time. Hearing tales of this traveling preacher, I dared my orthodoxy to the point of listening. He was a young man, barely 30, formerly a carpenter, they said, from the North Country, though with his plain tunic and plainer speech, it was hard to place him. Instantly, I knew. Young as he was, old and confirmed as I, he held some knowledge, some instinctive truth that one who read himself blind on occasion never possessed. The very core of life. Impossible for me, a member of the Sanhedrin, intellectually omnipotent, to address him there, the respectable tortoise must respect his shell. But I spoke to one of his disciples,
John, I think, and arranged a meeting later in his lodgings. It was a clear night, the Passover moon and a strong wind blowing. Concealing myself under my cloak, drawing it around my face, a precaution against the wind, I assured myself, I followed him down a labyrinth of streets till I found myself standing by an upper window in full moonlight, high above the city, the white light burnished on the temple roof. "It is he, Master, Nicodemus." I saw him watch my wrinkled neck emerge and knew he knew me. "You," I began, hiding beneath words, "are a teacher sent from God." It was difficult to continue, wanting knowledge and yet afraid of knowledge. He read my silence. "No man can reach the kingdom by thought alone. He must be reborn in the spirit." He spoke to a part of me I had often silenced, fearing the consequences of its rashness. I sought my shell again, feigning stupidity. "How, Master, can a man have two births?" "He, unless the Spirit conceives in him, the kingdom will never come." Another silence. Only the cool night wind rustling my silken robe, stirring the trees. I feared the fierceness of his truth might break me like a thrush with a snail. The more I believed, the stronger I must deny. How is it possible? How can God's Spirit enter us and renew? He quietly, "No need to question how it happens. The happening is enough. The wind blows where it will. You hear the sound and know its presence, but who can say where it comes from, where it goes?" Silence again. Someone preparing beds outside the trees like a distant sea, like waves breaking. What chance had half an hour with half a century of custom and observance? Sadly, I left him there and came away covering my ears, symbolic act, never to meet again. But still, I had news of him, followed him in my mind, the least arduous of journeys, up into Galilee, up through the fertile valleys of Samaria, into the lake country and the Phoenician hills. During his living presence, desiring his living presence more than life, and yet dreading more than death its consequence. Then in the third year, again at Passover time, he approached Jerusalem. I prayed that he might retreat for his sake as for mine. The Sanhedrin met, debating how to kill him, face after face, passionate for his end. I did not mean to speak. No, not courage. I had no thought of speaking. My heart beat so loudly on the bench behind, I rose to silence it. "Our law," I began, gripping the rail in front, "condemns no man without a hearing." Then I sank back, trembling and exhausted, my spirit sapped more than by hours of argument. The faces were turned to mine. "Are you from Galilee? Has he bedeviled you as well?" Amazed no more than I at my temerity, noting the gray flagstone between my feet, I left their taunts unanswered. My power had gone. When he was arraigned before the council, I pleaded sickness, kept to my house and drew my head in. With shame and sadness, I learned the sentence, unjust, unlawful, crucified by indecision, the two-way mind, torn as a body is between wild horses. I utter nothing, protesting nothing, listening to the duologue of my opposing selves, and then by evening when it was all over, I too was dead. Dead to all feeling, a breathing corpse, a walking conscience. I came into the air. In the bazaar of spices, I purchased myrrh and aloes, enough to serve the burial of an Egyptian king. I impressed the merchant, me. Nicodemus, it did not impress. With easy gold, I paid for the Christ's embalming. But to him, the living Christ, I had offered nothing less than a child's look or a passing cheer. I try to forget now. Routine is a great embalmer. Follow the pattern of my tapering days towards another tomb. Sometimes I succeed in forgetting. Sometimes I convince myself that prudence is man's greatest virtue, tortoisehood his supreme achievement. Only some evenings, when the night wind blows, my spirit stirs again, and I remember. I remember.
when our beloved died, all mankind died, said Philip, and all things for a space were still and gray. Then the east was darkened, and a tempest rushed out of it and swept the land. The eyes of the sky opened and shut, and the rain came down in torrents and carried away the blood that streamed from his hands and his feet. I too died, but in the depth of my oblivion I heard him speak and say, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. And his voice sought my drowned spirit, and I was brought back to the shore. And I opened my eyes, and I saw his white body hanging against the cloud. And his words that I had heard took shape within me, and I became a new man, and I sorrowed no more. Who would sorrow for a sea that is unveiling its face, or for a mountain that laughs in the sun? Was it ever in the heart of man, when that heart was pierced, to say such words? What other judge of men has released his judges? And did ever love challenge hate with power more certain of itself? Was ever such a trumpet heard betwixt heaven and earth? Was it known before that the murdered had compassion on his murderers? Or that the meteor stayed his footsteps for the mole? The seasons shall tire and the years grow old ere they exhaust these words. Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. And all the rivers of all the years shall not carry away this remembrance of him. He was a mountain burning in the night. Yet he was a soft glow beyond the hills. He was a tempest in the sky. Yet he was a murmur in the mist of daybreak. He was a torrent pouring from the heights to the plains to destroy all things in its path. And he was like the laugh of little children. Every year I had waited for spring to visit this valley of mine. I had waited for the lilies, and then every year my soul had been saddened within me, for ever I longed to rejoice with the spring, and yet somehow I could not quite rejoice. But when Jesus came to my seasons, he was indeed a spring, and in him was the promise of all the years to come. He filled my heart with joy, and like the violets, I grew a shy thing in the light of his coming. And now the changing seasons of worlds not yet ours shall not erase his loveliness from this our world. Nay, he was not a phantom nor a conception of the poets. He was a man like yourself and myself, but only to sight and touch and hearing. In all other ways, he was unlike us. He was a man of joy, and it was upon the path of joy that he met the sorrows of all men. And it was from the high roofs of his sorrows
that he beheld the joy of all men. He saw visions that we did not see and heard voices that we did not hear, and he spoke as if to invisible multitudes, and oftentimes he spoke through us to races yet unborn. And Jesus was often alone as I knew him. He was among us and yet not one with us. He was upon the earth, yet he was of the sky, and only in our aloneness may we visit the land of his aloneness. He loved us with tender love. His heart was a wine press. You and I could approach with a cup and drink therefrom. One thing I did not used to understand in Jesus, he would make merry with his listeners. He would tell jests and play upon words and laugh with all the fullness of his heart, even when there were distances in his eyes and sadness in his voice. But I think I understand now. I often think of the earth as a woman heavy with her first child. When Jesus was born, he was the first child, and when he died, he was the first man to die. For did it not appear to you that the earth was still on that dark Friday, and the heavens were at war with the heavens, and felt you not when his face disappeared from our sight, as if we were not but memories in the mist? I say to you, Jesus addresses Pilate, cast out fear. Speak no more vain things to me about the greatness of Rome. The greatness of Rome, as you call it, is nothing but fear. Fear of the past and fear of the future. Fear of the poor, fear of the rich. Fear of the high priests, fear of the Jews and the Greeks who are learned. Fear of the Gauls and the Goths and the Huns who are barbarians. Fear of the Carthage you destroyed to save you from fear of it. And now fear worse than ever, fear of Imperial Caesar, the idol you have yourself created, and fear of me, the penniless vagrant, buffeted and mocked, fear of everything except the rule of God. Faith in nothing but blood and iron and gold. You, Pilate, standing for Rome, are the universal coward. I, standing for the kingdom of God, have braved everything, lost everything, and won an eternal crown. I shall die, but that is all that I shall do for death. I hear him leading his horse out of the stall. I hear the clatter on the barn floor. He is in haste. He has business in Cuba, business in the Balkans, many calls to make this morning, but I will not hold the bridle while he cinches the girth. And he may mount by himself, I will not give him a leg up, though he flick my shoulder with his whip. I will not tell him which way the fox ran. With his hoof on my breast, I will not tell him where the black boy hides in the swamp. I shall die. But that is all that I shall do for death. I am not on death's payroll. I will not tell him the whereabouts of my friends, nor of my enemies either. Though he promise me much, I will not map him the route to any man's door. Am I a spy in the land of the living that I should deliver men to death? Brothers, the password and the plans of our city are safe with me. Never through me shall you be overcome. I shall die, but that is all that I shall do. For death, I am not on death's payroll. May we read silently or listen as the organist plays hymn number 120. We may not climb the heavenly steeps to bring the Lord Christ down.
It was a cruel price he paid. The biggest, utmost price. They hate his love and he suffered it. They mocked his truth and he suffered it. They twisted his words and twisted his motives and bore false witness against him. Still he suffered it. He bared his heart like a brother. He witnessed for truth. Like a prophet, he forgave like a saint. He opened the heavens like a god. And they fell on him, and the hate struck at the brother, and lies smote at the prophet, and malignance clutched at the saint, and hell spewed its venom. And so at last he died. But he endured and suffered all as one who abates not one jot or one tittle of what is right and good and true, lest the blazing path should be made dim. Now on this path, through countless generations, shall man in him learning love's life walk into the glorious liberty of the children of God. And sitting down, I watched you there, Galilean, for in a dream you were upon your cross again, and the wan light struggled cold through a torn cloud and glistened palely on your body. I looked at you for a long time, and afterward I said, Master, can you speak to me? And the great silence was broken, and you said, I could have escaped as I escaped before, but every avoidance was only postponement. Unless I was ready to change my way, it had to come to this. Had I changed my way, I could have saved my skin. Can a man think as I thought and not be crucified at last by what men think? All the prophets who went before me and all who will come after me are my witnesses that I wear their crown and suffer their piercing. The Father has spoken through us all. And you said, hanging there, man is a fearful contradiction against himself. I should rather be here with my faith in him than elsewhere sharing his unbelief. For all his sin, as I see man, man is worth being here for. By this fidelity to the God in me, man may yet hear me calling to the God in him. God is everything to man. Everything. To the measure that a man does not know it, he has nothing. Are you our substitute, as they say, I ask? Are we saved by something you are doing in our stead? And you answered, I can do nothing in your stead. I can only show you what to do and how life comes.
unless a man lay down his life, yield it to God's purpose for the world, he will never find it, never, and only in the offering of himself is there either peace or power. Believe in me and live. And the silence came down again. Sitting there, I watched you a little while longer, Galilean. And then I said, you dreamed a dream that was resented. And rather than betray it, you bore right onward and received the shock of men's resentment in yourself. You are killed by men's sin. As I said that, I noticed how a leafless shrub growing gaunt from the stones shuddered in the bleak wind that of a sudden moaned and passed. I rose up and I walked over to you, Galilean, and I said, God wins when men believe in him and in man like this. This is God's victory. This is how the sin of the world may be taken away. But how much of himself should a man give? You did not answer me, Galilean. And in the awful stillness, I saw your head was sunken on your breast. There was no more that you could give. No more. Whenever there is silence around me by day and by night, I'm startled by a cry. It came down from the cross. The first time I heard it, I went out and searched and found a man in the throes of crucifixion, and I said, I will take you down. And I tried to take the nails out of his feet, but he said, let them be, for I cannot be taken down until every man and every woman and every child come together to take me down. And I said, but I cannot stand to hear you cry. What can I do? And he said, go about the world. Tell everyone that you meet that there's a man on the cross. A man on the cross. Tell everybody. Everybody that you meet. There was no glory on the hills that day. Only dark shame and three stark crosses rearing at the sky. Only a whining wind and an anguished voice crying forgiveness. and then darkness fell. We sit today in cushioned pews, and for 3 hours we watch with him singing and praying, hearing quiet words. There is a gentle rustle as we move in and out, too busy to stay long, or else too tired to sit so long a time in a single place. We see a golden cross and pray to God that someday in his own good time the world may do his will. But we ourselves have little time to help, except to say a prayer in the place where we sit. The golden cross is all aglow. The candle flames like flame, it burns in my heart. The golden cross is turned to fire. The candle glow has set the cross on fire. The burning cross upon the altar cries, it cries out to me. The flaming cross is burned into my heart. The others have not seen. There is the golden cross and the candle glow. There was no glory on the hills that day, but one stark cross against a vacant sky. Go about the world. Tell everyone that you meet. There's a man on the cross. There's a man. There's a man on the cross.
There's a man on the cross.